Welcome viewers to the lecture series that we have today, and it has been going on for quite some time now. I think about 10 lectures have already happened, and today's lecture is significant in the sense that it is talking about one of the important women writers in the 19th century, and she also came to the 20th century. And then there are certain texts, you know, where she talked about the issues that concern this half of the Indian population. So we have on this topic Professor Payal Nagpal with us to talk about it. Dr. Payal Nagpal is a teacher in a Delhi University's college, and she also is a theatre person and a critic. Apart from this, she also writes poems. So we have with us a very able speaker, and I'm sure that he will be able to inspire you to discuss, to think about the issue. So, Dr. Payal Nagpal, please.
Thank you, Dr. Amprakash. Today's lecture is going to be about, as Dr. Prakash pointed out, a very, very significant woman writer. Her name is Rukaiya Shekhawat Hussain. Rukaiya Shekhawat Hussain was born in 1880 in a place called Pairaband in Rangpur district. It is in present-day Bangladesh. And she has written some very, very important novellas, narratives, such as Sultana's Dream, Padmarag. And they are important because they are extremely, path-breaking in lots of ways. So today's lecture is going to focus on, firstly, Rukaiya Shekhawat Hussain's life, little bit about her life to understand the time period in which she lived, and we will then move on to a discussion of, a detailed discussion of the feminist utopic narrative, Sultana's Dream, and we will then move on to a discussion of, a very brief discussion of Padmarag. Now, as I just mentioned that born in 1880, we can understand that this is absolutely towards the end of the 19th century, and in the historically speaking, in the context of India, this was also a period of great change, and everybody was getting very, very activated and moving towards the intensification of the struggle for freedom in India. Rukaiya's life is very, very interesting because she belongs to a time period where women were not educated. It was not considered important to educate women. So, and likewise, Rukaiya also did not receive any formal education. However, it is her brother, Ibrahim Saber, who had actually taught her to read and write in both English and in Bengali. So she shared a very, very close bond with her siblings because of these things. And it's important to see that, she dedicates Sultana's Dream, when it appeared in the book form, to her sister Karimunnesa, and dedicates Padmarag to her brother Ibrahim Saber. Barnita Bakchi, who has actually translated Padmarag, also mentions her life and discusses her life in great detail and is extremely informative. Another factor that is mentioned is about how Secluded Ones is dedicated to her mother, Rahatun Nisa Sabera Chaudhurani. So having come from a milieu, as I said, where education was not provided to women, we see Rukaiya receiving an informal education through her brother, and she was of course married off quite early at the age of 16 to Sayyid Shekhawat Hussain, who was a deputy magistrate, and she shifted to Bhagalpur, Bihar. Now it's also important to note that at that point of time Sayyid Shekhawat Hussain was a widower, was about 40 years of age, and however, he was extremely supportive of Rukaiya and her interests, her pursuits in the context of education. And he always encouraged her to read more and to write. So she was known more as Mrs. R.S. Hussain, and the term Begum Rukaiya was actually conferred upon her much later. So it is the support from her husband that allows her to explore issues that she felt very, very strongly about, issues such as the education of women. And in fact, when her husband dies, he left a huge amount of money with which to start a girls' school. And Rukaiya was very, very actively and deeply involved in the education and the welfare of girls. She set up a school for girls in Bhagalpur in 1909 and later on in Calcutta. By 1932, in fact, that's the year she died, the Shekhawat Memorial School had become a high school, and by about 1935, it started receiving government grants and funding and became a very, very well-established educational institution. Another aspect that she worked on was, you know, how she, in 1916, she found the Bengal branch of the Anjuman-e-Khawatin-e-Islam that undertook welfare activities for Muslim women, including providing literary assistance. So in this context, if we were to just kind of, you know, look at the important aspects of Rukaiya Shekhawat Hussain's life, I think we need to keep in mind that she represents a group of women who did not receive education, and how this education was given to them in a very, very informal sort of manner. And it is important to keep in mind at the same time that Rukaiya belonged to, you know, the wealthy landowning class. But these were factors that went on to frame her sensibility in a very, very specific manner. So with this in mind, one can also see this stress on the education of women that comes from Rukaiya and can be seen very well graphed in both these narratives that we are going to discuss today, Sultana's Dream and Padmarag. So another you know, writer who has worked extensively on Rukaiya's life and works mentions about how she came to write Sultana's Dream during an idyll interlude and when she was alone at home. And Roshan Jahan says that her writing was partly to demonstrate her proficiency in English to her non-Bengali husband. And Jahan surmises that he was her immediate and appreciative audience. It's important here to keep in mind the fact that Sultana's Dream was originally written in English. Now, here we are talking about education that is, you know, coming in a very, very informal context, and yet Rukaiya is able to kind of, you know, struggle against these circumstances. And in 1905, she writes Sultana's Dream, which is written in English. And we also see the concern, we see Rukaiya Shekhawat Hussain not only as a woman, but also as a woman writer who is struggling with this language and who's also trying to kind of articulate her thoughts in this language. So this was primarily actually her sole attempt to write in English, because after that most of the works that she wrote were written in Bengali. So there is in that sense, you know, a kind of continuity in Rukaiya Shekhawat Hussain's work. So along with Padmarag, which was written in Bengali, Sultana's Dream is considered to be, you know, a narrative of feminist utopia, right? And we are using two very important terms here. A, we are placing Rukaiya within the structure of feminism, and we are looking at Sultana's Dream as a feminist utopia. So the first question that one needs to address is, what do we mean by a utopia? So utopia in a sense signifies a space of perfection, something that is perfect and is in that sense the ideal structure. So what was Rukaiya trying to say in Sultana's Dream when she presents the ideal world in terms of a place that she calls Ladyland? The place is called the utopia that we are going to discuss is called Ladyland. So if Rukaiya Shekhawat Hussain is talking about a space that is perfect, this space is primarily meant for women. So how is it that we kind of move on to discuss and understand what can be that ideal space for women? And when we kind of elaborate on this, I think what you need to keep in mind is that here is a text that is written in 1905, right? And the concept of feminism, if one is to use that word, has to be understood in that context and also applied to understand how we in the 21st century, really speaking, look at the concerns that Rokeya Shekhawat Hussain voices in Sultana's dream. So moving on from this idea of perfection, as I said that, you know, we need to focus on what the different aspects of perfection are, and, you know, as expressed in this space that she calls Lady Land. Interestingly, we have with us today the course coordinator of this course on Indian writing in English, Dr. Anand Prakash, and I would request him to also comment a little bit on the term utopia and you know, how specifically it also applies to women.
You see, it's a very interesting term in the sense, you know, that this idea of utopia started with Renaissance England, and it might have traveled from there to different parts of the world, and it also came to India, because this person you are talking about is a writer in English, or she is well versed in English, even though she writes in Bangla later. So she must have heard of, if not read, you know, that famous book called Utopia by Thomas More, who was a 16th century writer and a very well known person, very well known personality in European literature. So this person, as you rightly say, was talking about this ideal land or the perfect land, where, you know, the human beings are given this task to construct their own world. So God is not doing it. God is equipping human beings with intellect, and after that these people think of a land where there will be justice, where there will be equality. So that is the original meaning of utopia, that it's a place which exists nowhere. It's a nowhere land, and therefore out of nothing, out of zero, you construct a world which is after your heart. So if it's women's utopia, if it's a lady land, then definitely women also would be dreaming as to what the world should be. And that world, you know, is going to follow certain principles made by the women for their good. Of course, women writers, like men writers have to be, do not bother about, you know, the sex or gender distinction, and therefore everybody is equal for them. But women writers have a greater job to perform. So that way, I think it's quite interesting, and utopia for women is something that I am curious to know about. So you might, in fact, tell me also.
Right. In fact, as you very rightly pointed out, there are two things that we need to keep in mind when we use the term utopia, that it's the ideal land, but it's also the nowhere land, because it doesn't exist anywhere. So this structure of the ideal becomes very important. Especially in the context of women, both in the early 20th century and even more so today, that, you know, what is going to be that ideal space that women are going to occupy, and what is life going to be like in this ideal space. And I also want to share with you how this novella, as it's called, it just spans about 14 pages. It's just about 14 pages, and within these 14 pages, Rokeya Shekhawat Hussain has packed so many ideas that it's a utopia, it's a pioneering text in terms of Indian science fiction. So lots of things, and I think it's exemplary, particularly in terms of the ideals of humanity that it expresses, and that is very, very significant. So if we actually, I'll just read out maybe just the first statement. And in fact, the first part may be in just, two statements separately to make you understand the two different concepts of, you know, utopia as the ideal land, and also the fact that, you know, it's nowhere, and how Rukaya actually brings it out. So, you know, the novella begins like this. One evening, I was lounging in an easy chair in my bedroom and thinking lazily of the condition of Indian womanhood. So, the one thing that is very clearly mentioned is that this text is going to be about the condition of Indian womanhood. So the ideal space in that sense is also going to be a comment on the things that are possibly missing in the real world. and the structure as to how she brings about this concept of the dream is very important. And she says that, I am not sure whether I dozed off or not, but as far as I remember, I was wide awake. I saw the moonlit sky sparkling with thousands of diamond-like stars very distinctly. So the ideas, the novella is presented as if in a dream, and Rukaiya is in this dream contemplating about, she's thinking about the condition of Indian womanhood. So and one must also pay special attention to a very, very confident and relaxed style of writing, in the sense that, you know, there is no the anxieties are very well kept at bay and are in a sense overpowered through the world that is ideal, through the world of the utopia. Because, you know, the word lazily here, I think, is a very telling word, when she says that, I was lounging in an easy chair in my bedroom and thinking lazily of the condition of Indian womanhood. We must keep in mind that 1905, the time that this text was written, was also historically very, very significant. And this is the time period that a lot of women were increasingly getting involved in the independence struggle, in social reform movements. And Rukaiya's concerns here are, of course, best understood when placed in this context. So, as she contemplates very lazily on the plight of women in India, she highlights how this is actually done in a dream. Now, there are many aspects of this ideal world that Rukaiya talks about.
Nagpal, I would like to stop you here for a little while to, you know, focus upon the, as you rightly said, the associations and implications of laziness. Laziness does not mean, as you pointed out, that one is lazy regarding considering. It's that, you know, you require a kind of rest. You require a kind of contemplative mood. And when that happens, then only you can write. Then only you can think about the world. So lazy is a very important term, and I really appreciate the way you have explained it.
Yes. And particularly, I was very struck by the fact that there is this sense of confidence for a woman who's actually, in a sense, I can say, experimenting almost when she writes in English. Mm-hmm. So, and this is probably, I think, one of the only ones, only novellas that is written in English. Mm-hmm. This very, very strange confidence that is there in her writing, mm-hmm, is something that is very striking. And it also expresses a confidence that I think the writer has, that Rukaiya has, in her own ideas about womanhood.
And see the irony. The irony is that unless women are given some time to think, they will not think about these things. All the time is spent in household chores. All the time is spent, you know, worrying for what's going to happen tomorrow. But if a woman is lazy, if a woman has rest, then she sits back and then talks about the world that she wants to be in. So I really appreciate.
Right. Absolutely. In fact, this kind of space to relax is something that is part of the utopia. Yes. That is something that Rukaiya dwells on in great detail, in fact. Mm. So, when we discuss the different aspects of this utopia, I think the very first aspect of this utopia is that the structure of the janana here has been the space where women are expected to be and are kept, has been reversed and is referred to as the mardana. It is the ladyland is a world that is, I wouldn't say free of men, but the men are actually kept confined in, the mardana space, as it is called, and they cannot roam around freely. It is the women who actually roam around freely. Now, Rukaiya posits no faith here in men whom she thinks play mischief, and the word that she uses specifically is mischief. So, where in Sultana's world, it is the women who are kept captive. In Ladyland, it is reversed, and this is a very, very sharp and distinct role reversal. And at least to my mind, I think Rukaiya Shekhawat Hussain is doing this very, very consciously, where she's not suggesting any kind of confinement, I think, but she's also mentioning this to drive home the realization of what confinement can mean, and also the fact that this community of women is something that is the ideal community, and this community of women is what can lead to more constructive and more productive forces in life, and it is from this that we really need to take our cue regarding Sultana's dream.
Would you like to dilate upon the word mischief?
Rukaya Shikhawathasan uses this word very deliberately and says that it is the men who are responsible for creating the mischief, in the sense of actually creating very, very unhappy circumstances for women in more ways than one, in not just simply in kind of confining them or in torturing them in any form, but it is also, I think, the general patriarchal structure that she's also trying to reverse here, and is concentrating on that by speaking about the replacement of the Janana with the Mardana.
So it's an operative word.
It is an operative word. Mm. It is an operative word, and she's, as I said, that, you know, taking our cue from the word, the relaxed word lazy leaf, where she contemplates on the plight of Indian women. She's very deliberately focusing on these factors. So and also writing in 1905, mm. this is certainly a very, very bold stance to take, mm. and where she's absolutely forthright and clear in her mind about the ideal female, the ideal space for women. So where it seems here, and I would just very briefly like to dwell on the kind of feminism that we are talking about here. From the 21st century perspective, it would be extremely unfair to impose any idea onto a woman writer who is writing in 1905, because to say that, you know, this is a feminism that looks at binaries and so on would be unfair judgment. What we need to understand is that Sultana's dream is a text that needs to be placed historically in terms of this very felt need for creating a space where women can be happy, where they can be comfortable, where they can feel free, and where they can move around freely. So I think that becomes a very, very, that becomes an operative word for us here. So she is not merely suggesting a world that is devoid of men, because the men are still there, though they are, of course, kept in the Mardana. But they are kept in the Mardana, as, you know, Dr. Prakash rightly pointed out, because of the word mischief. And these forces then need to be kept away. And it is the women who should be able to then walk around freely, uninhibited, without fear. And this space, this possibility of, you know, the kind of freedom that Rukaya is exploring in the context of women, at least to her mind, it is possible only when it is the men who are kept, in the Mardana space. And, kind of connected to this is a very, very important word, which is called manish. And, when Sultana is walking with the person she thinks is Sister Sara, right? And she, throughout the novella, she refers to the person from Ladyland as Sister Sara. And Sister Sara tells Sultana that people are looking at her and passing comments because they find her very mannish. And so she wants to know what mannish means. And she says, well, to be mannish is to be very shy and timid. So there is this complete reversal that Rukaya is kind of bringing out here. So to be shy and timid is mannish. This complete inversion of context, draws attention to this lack, actually, in the usual patriarchal scheme of things, that if we look at it, you know, we are so used to looking at things in only one particular way that it becomes very difficult for us to dissociate meaning from a particular word and to look at it in an entirely different manner. So I think by actually pushing it to this extreme of binaries, Rukaya is also drawing attention very sharply, in fact, to a society, to a system, to a patriarchal structure that has made us accept these terms only in one particular manner. So, Sultana, in fact, in Sultana's dream, carries that anxiety, and she's absolutely intrigued and does not know how to respond, that to be mannish is to be shy and timid in this world. So that's the ideal space that we are really talking about. I think this, if we keep this particular aspect in mind, this is one of the ideas that Sultana's dream focuses on, especially in the context of feminism. Welcome, friends. We've been discussing Rukaiya Shekhawat Hussain's Sultana's Dream, and we discussed this aspect about the complete inversion of roles in the space called Lady Land, the female utopia that is sketched out for us in Sultana's Dream. In it, to be a man means to be in the mardana, to be kept in the mardana, and the term mannish, was being described as shy and timid, and as I mentioned that, Sultana's response to this actually in a sense expresses the response of the reader, because we too wonder, can we look at mannish in this way, because one is so used to attaching only a specific kind of meaning to words in a patriarchal system. So the defining feature of Lady Land is very well expressed by Rukaiya. She writes that it is free from sin and harm. Virtue herself reigns here. With this discussion, in this discussion with Dr. Ann Prakash, we also focused on the word mischief. And I think that is kind of further clarified here, especially with reference to the terms free from sin and harm, and how virtue herself reigns here. The fact that virtue is possible, freedom is possible, freedom from sin, freedom from harm is possible, but only when the men are kept at a distance. This is Rukaiya's idea of the utopia. So the resident of Lady Land, whom of course she's been referring to as Sister Sarah, gives an interesting analogy, and she says, what are you going to do with people, who are insane, who have escaped from the asylum? So Sultana responds by saying, well, they need to be locked up. And then Sister Sarah, who's from Lady Land, tells her how in Sultana's country, it is the men who are capable of mischief, and it is the men who are let loose, and it is the women who are kept captive. So she says, going by normal logic would tell you that people who are causing mischief should be kept confined, should be kept captive. Whereas what is happening in Sultana's world, the world that Sultana comes from, is exactly the reverse. She says, so in a sense, by doing this, you are defying the natural logic of things, right? And the natural logic would then entail that the women should actually roam around freely. So Lady Lan is not an impossible task as far as Sister Sarah looks at it. So Sister Sarah feels that Lady Lan is a space that follows rationality, that follows a scientific attitude, and follows logic. And it is so, which I think here we also need to ask another question: why is it that we defy this logic? Why is it that we allow the mischievous elements, whatever they, whoever they be, to roam around freely? And it is actually, the people who are, rational, they are the ones who are probably, kept confined. Now, I think here the understanding has to be placed in the context of structures of power that compel people to, either look at words, look at concepts, look at ideas only in one unidirectional, linear sort of manner, instead of actually understanding it in terms of, a scientific and rational attitude. In Sultana's country, as Sister Sarah mentions, man is lord and master. And to this, Sister Sarah says something very, very important. The character, Sister Sarah, says something very important. And here we understand Rukaya's concerns very clearly. She says, you have neglected your duty, the duty that you owe to yourselves, and you have lost your natural right to yourselves by shutting your eyes to your own interests. So, which means that what is humanity? Humanity would entail that women, like men, women too, should focus on their own interests, should focus on what they want. Whereas that is something that is not really allowed to happen, which means that the natural rights, and the term natural right to yourselves, is something that is totally done away with. And I think it really rings a very important bell here when we actually compare it in the context of the situation of women even today in the 21st century. So that this nothing artificial. The fact that Rukaya refers to these as natural rights clarifies that there is nothing absolutely artificial about this. There is nothing acquired about these rights. This is the right that any and every human being has towards herself. So in this, I would actually, because this connects with the question that we had discussed previously with Dr. Prakash on, how women should actually have the space, the required space to really speaking do their own thing, but that is something that is not accorded to them. So when Sister Sarah mentions that you have neglected this duty to yourselves, I would like to bring in Dr. Prakash and request him to comment a little bit about this particular aspect, about how women are completely in that sense deprived of that space to think about what is it that they really want, first of all, even before really speaking, kind of bringing that to fruition.
I am particularly struck by the use of the word self. Women have a self, they have a right, and they have something to express, something to aspire for. And so far, not a single time has the word occurred that this is the woman's role, that she is a mother, she is a daughter, she is a sister, and all those things. So which means that a woman outside these familial or social roles has the kind of selfhood that that one has to think of. And this the writers in particular can think of, can imagine. Does a woman have a self outside the home, outside the relations that we think of? I've already counted the relations. Not for a single time has this occurred, and I'm so very well struck. And I think this is a new idea. that women should be seen from the point of view of selfhood, that they are women, not sisters, not daughters, but citizens and equal citizens, and citizens who have to live on the terms that they themselves construct. So suppose this is the question, how would you respond to it?
Absolutely, because today particularly, you know, we talk a lot about the self and the construction of the self. These are terms that are very commonly used. But I don't think, I mean, anyway, I haven't really seen it etched out and it, you know, kind of elaborated so well, so confidently anywhere as in Rukaiya's novella, Sultana's Dream, because here she is not involving and not entangling the women of Ladyland in any of these roles. Mm-hmm. The women are able to roam around freely and explore whatever it is that they want to, and such an absolute judicious use of time. That is something that is very well explored in this
Which means that women will be considered in the Ladyland as individuals.
Yes.
As individuals who are working out their strategies to enjoy, strategies to assert themselves. This is what the dream is.
Yes.
And this dream cannot be realized in the present day world. It can be realized only in a world which is constructed specifically by women after their imagination.
Right.
Is that what she's
yes.
saying?
Yes. And also that there is no interference in this imagination.
Mm-hmm.
There is no interference from any kind of any other overpowering structure.
Mm-hmm.
The only structure that exists is that of Ladyland.
Mm-hmm.
There is nothing else that impinges on these women.
And since you earlier talked about the scientific part, the imagination part, so the idea of any kind of faith, the faith that governs us, faith that, you know, sanctifies our behavior, that is also kept out.
Yes, all of it, in fact. The only faith that exists here is the faith that human beings should have towards each other, that of love, shared interests, humanity. And in fact, since this idea about the scientific has been raised, we need to now also look at Sultana's dream in terms of, you know, some of the new scientific ideas that she explores in this novella. As I said, that, you know, packed in 14 pages are so many new ideas, which is why it is also considered to be a text that is pioneering in terms of, you know, Indian science fiction. So, if you look at the characteristics of this utopia in Ladyland, you know, the fact that women roam around freely, what really speaking are the different aspects of this community of women is something that Rukaiya dwells on. So the women, you know, the fact that all the women are working, Sultana is struck by the fact that Sister Sara also finds time to embroider, and she's got these really beautifully embroidered tipoy, you know, things that are kept around her. So she asks her, she says in, Sultana asks her that, you know, in Sultana's world, the men work for about 7 hours a day. And Sister Sara responds very well by saying that actually they spend most of their time smoking, and if you look at the work that is done, it's only for about 2 hours. So in Ladyland, time is very, very important. Time to work and also time to relax. So they work for only 2 hours every day, not 7 hours. So the women find that unlike the 7 hours of work in Sultana's world, the women need work only for 2 hours, because this is concentrated work and they are not distracted and not involved in anything. Now this utopia is also free of disease. It is epidemic free. People, you know, seldom die due to accidents. It's something that's very, very rare. And there seems to be absolutely, you know, this world of mutual respect, where the women have complete regard for each other's ideas. This utopia is also absolutely an alternative space, even, you know, going by the standards today, where we think about all sorts of alternative methodologies, whether it comes to agriculture, whether it comes to storage of water, whether it comes to solar power. So here is this novella that talks about tending to plants, almost as if, and you know, it's Rukaiya describes how each plant here, even each tomato here, is looked at as an ornament, because there is so much effort and there is so much of tending that goes into it. There's no smoke here in Ladyland. There are no coals, no fire that is used to cook anything because they rely on solar power. And there is also a reference to, even though we might think that this is of course purely in the imagination, how there is a captive balloon that is used to trap water and through pipes, and this water is passed on to the people of Ladyland, the women of Ladyland. And Sister Sara then recounts a little story to Sultana and tells her how these discoveries, how the women at a time when men also roamed around freely, this place was ruled by the queen, and in effect it was not the queen but it was the prime minister who was actually running the place. Now one of the things that the queen had done was to ensure education for women and to pass the rule that no woman below the age of 21 will be allowed to get married. Now this was very important because what it does is it leads to women going in for higher education, women joining universities. And in the novel, this is what is happening. There are two universities that are established for women, and where one university comes up with this idea of solar power, the other university comes up with the idea of rainwater harvesting through the captive balloon and pipes that pass it on. So as a result, and Sultana notices that this is the reason why there is no mud, there is nothing, there is no smoke, no mud, and everybody is doing their work at a certain pace, and that pace is very, very important. So tilling is done by electricity, but no railroads, no paved ways and paved streets. And the chief food that people have in Ladyland is fruits. So it is in this narrative, a kind of story within a story, where Sister Sara recounts the history of Ladyland and how it came about that all the men were confined to the Mardana instead of the women being in the Janana. So post this discussion about the education of women, the fact that women were not allowed to get married before they were 21, it allowed them to explore new ideas and adopt a scientific, rational attitude. There was this healthy competition between the two universities that is very clearly mentioned in this novella. Now, the men, however, at this time, before they were confined to the Mardana, were involved, of course, in their military activities. And when the queen gave shelter to some people from the neighboring country, the king of that particular place was very, very displeased about it, and he attacked what we understand to be Ladyland, and the men of this land were kind of totally defeated. And finally, the queen approached these women who were studying in the university, and these were the wise women. So they said that they agreed to help out, and they said they had only one condition, which was that all the men would first have to go into the Mardana. Only then will they suggest some measures to ward off this attack on Ladyland. And what the women did was they used the solar power, the heat that they had trapped, and they reflected it onto the army that had invaded their land. And because they could not take the heat, these forces were defeated, and the women were victorious. And these discoveries, which were of course referred to by the men as a kind of sentimental indulgence, is something that is now that saves the honor of Ladyland, so to say. So it is the educated women who suggest a way out, but of course, as mentioned, that only after sending the men to the space of confinement. So interestingly, on being asked by Sultana, and this is something that we really need to understand, on being asked by Sultana as to how the law and order was maintained because all the men were there. So, you know, who would hold the important posts and so on. The assumption being that it is only, you know, Sultana's assumption here being that it's the men who are going to hold these important positions. But Sister Sara says, since the Mardana has been established, there has been no crime in Ladyland. And this very, very clear-cut binary distinction that, you know, Rukaiya adopts here, and is very clear that if there is any kind of mischief, it is only happening because of the men. And this is, of course, an idea that is explored also later in her novel written in 1924 called Padmarag, where, you know, the female protagonist, who's initially kind of left and rejected, you know, by the husband, there is a misunderstanding and so on. But the end of the novel is very, very interesting, where there is, despite the fact that Padmarag or Siddhika and Latif Almas share sentiments for each other, the marriage does not happen. And through the spokesperson of Tarini Bhavan, you know, Dina Tarini, Rukaiya mentions how it is important for women to actually make this sacrifice, even if it were looked at as a sacrifice, so that the education of women, the welfare of women could actually be looked after. So there are more important concerns than this. So getting back to this whole question about the security of Ladyland and the maintenance of law and order. So Rukaiya very clearly mentions that ever since the men have been there, there is no need for, there is no crime. So there is no need for anybody to take care of these spaces. The Queen's vision here is worth noting, and her ambition is to convert the world into one grand garden. And I think here the last and the most important aspect of Sultana's dream emerges, which is that of a humanitarian vision. You know, we talk about humanity, but what is this vision of humanity? This vision of humanity is one where there is mutual respect, there is freedom, there is, interestingly, in this Ladyland, punishment is not by death. Anybody who commits a crime, firstly, there is none, but if there was a problem, the person is asked to leave Ladyland and to never return to the space. So that in itself is taken to be punishment enough for the culprit. After this, there is also reference to this air carriage that Sultana and Sister Sara sit in, and you know, Sister Sara takes her to the Queen, and it is in you know, it is only after the meeting with the Queen that Sultana feels as if she's fallen, and she suddenly kind of wakes up from the dream. So the Queen's words, however, before this are interesting, because she attacks the local customs and also the policies of, one can say, in 1905, of the colonizers. She explains how no trade is possible where women are kept confined. She says that Ladyland will not trade with any country that confines women. And she says that Ladyland will also not conduct any dealings with the men, because they are considered to be low of morals. And at the same time, there's a very important line that is spoken by the Queen, where she says, "We do not covet other people's land. We do not fight for a piece of diamond, nor do we grudge a ruler his peacock throne." So this element of, I think, satisfaction is something that is very, very crucial to Ladyland. So in the light of this, I think if there is you know, something that Dr. Prakash, you'd also like to add to
it's all very lucid. It's all very lucid, and you know, you've been able to very clearly tell us regarding the administration, regarding the worth of men's behavior, and the need to confine them to a corner, and that women, you know, occupy center stage, and they can manage the world better. This has come out very well, and I don't think that requires any more explanation. You have done it so well. Now, there are one or two questions that I would like to ask, you know, as a fellow scholar. You see, there are three women characters, as you point out. There is Rukaiya, there is her sister, and there is the Queen. And these three people are used by the author to project a vision. Now, in this, how do they interact, these three characters? Are they different? Are they to represent the same voice and they are three different forms of the same voice, or do they also have a kind of discourse, also have a kind of discussion, and that they complement each other, or they sometimes you know, go at variance with each other?
I think that's a very important point, because these two, the three women, you know, we have Sultana, we have Sister Sara, and we have Queen. And behind all this, of course, we have the author, Rukaya Shekhawat Hussain. So, where Sultana represents the questions, the notions, the assumptions of what we would call is the normal way of life. Sister Sara, who belongs to Ladyland, which is the female utopia, contests this notion and brings in a totally different idea, a totally new idea. And this new idea is a space that is very, very women friendly, that is friendly for humanity, and it is something that, it is a world that allows expression and allows the female self to develop and to evolve. So, and in the discussions primarily happen between Sister Sara and Sultana. So, where one is constantly questioning the other and is finding everything very strange. But here, as I said, that, you know, something that I began with, that this complete role reversal of a complete rejection of men, of putting them in another space altogether, is something that really needs interpretation, is something that we need to dwell on, because it is through this that the lack of space, the lack of freedom for women in Sultana's world is pointed out, and the complete lack that is there. Another very important factor that we must keep in mind is that Sultana's dream does not talk about marriage in that sense, right? And it does not dwell on it. And when we move on to the 1924 novel Padmarag, there is a almost complete rejection in that sense of marriage, even though there are women who've had good marriages. But most women, and all these women in Tarini Bhavan, kind of mention their stories of trauma, and all these are related to marriage, and how in the end then, even though Latif Almas and Padmarag harbor sentiments for each other and are shown to be two good human beings, but Rukaya is suggesting a way outside marriage, and the fact that women need to engage with more productive and more constructive forces in life rather than being bound somewhere. So, which is why, getting back to Sultana's dream, this role reversal actually becomes very, very important, because all the exploitative forces, in a sense, you know, especially through the institution of marriage and so on, are kept at bay. So, in fact, in the context of marriage, there is an interesting statement that is made, where she says, "Why display your husband's wealth on your body? That is nothing but a symbol of slavery. Prisoners wear handcuffs made of iron. We wear bracelets made of gold and silver." So I think with this, the sentiments that Rukaya expresses in Sultana's dream, so you know, become very, very pointed and acquire a great significance in today's world. Kind of sum up Sultana's dream, I think you need to concentrate, you need to focus on the fact that it is put forth as a utopia for women. So what for you in today's world, you know, is really the utopia, and what was the kind of utopia that Rukaya Shekhawat Hussain was suggesting in this very, very early 20th century? Another you know, aspect that you have to think about is not only scientific methods that are suggested in this novella of you know, either solar power or rainwater harvesting, but women's engagement with these is very, very significant, and how this can only come about through education. So with this, I hope you enjoyed today's session on Rukaya Shekhawat Hussain's novella Sultana's Dream. Thank you.
Well, viewers, we have had a wonderful lecture on this important text of the early 20th century, and in this analysis we are now aware of a kind of imagination, a kind of sense of freedom that women can also have, and then they can put forward an alternative paradigm So I thank Dr. Nagpal for this wonderful lecture. And viewers, if you have any queries, if you have any questions, if you have disagreements, if you have observations to share, then you are welcome to approach us at info.cec@nic.in. Thank you, and thank you, Dr. Nagpal, for this great lecture.
Thank you, Dr.